Good morning. I'm Robert Scusi. I'm the chair of the planning committee for the Robert L. Hess Scholar Residence Program. And our guest this semester, in fact, is here, is Thomas Frank, a very distinguished political analyst, all-around smart guy. He dazzled us all day yesterday. I don't know if he's got anything left to dazzle us, but we have an interesting conversation this morning on the question, is there a left public sphere, right and not the left? And the chair for this session is Liza Featherstone, who is the Bill Zeller Professor of Political Science here at Brooklyn College, and she will introduce the speakers. One of them is not here yet.
Right, yeah. Professor Funke Okome should be here, but I don't see her, so we're gonna get started. I'm really honored to be doing this. I'm gonna introduce the other panelists, each of which are engaged in their own way in the left public sphere. Tom Frank, just to add to Bob's introduction. I first became aware of Tom in the 90s when he founded an alternative publication called The Baffler, which is a magazine of left culture and political commentary that is still going strong. I still actually read it regularly, and it's still really great. He then went on to write a number of influential books, among them What's the Matter with Kansas, which got a lot of attention, including by major national politicians. And he's most recently the author of a book called Pity the Billionaire. He's also been a columnist, and this is where I really enjoy reading his work. He was a columnist for Harper's for a while, and has most recently moved to Salon, which is an entirely online publication. So we can see that in Tom's own career, there's a lot to be said about the changes in the public sphere and the changes in where public debate takes place. So we'll be getting into that quite a bit as well. Louis Fishman is a professor here at Brooklyn College. He works on Turkish and Israeli-Palestinian affairs, and his upcoming book is on Ottoman Palestine. And you can follow him on Twitter, speaking of the changes in the public sphere, at Istanbul, Tel Aviv, and he blogs at lewisfishman.blogspot.com. He writes a lot for Haaretz, an important Israeli newspaper, and is an excellent addition to our panel. Alan Aja is a professor in the Puerto Rican and Latino Studies program here at Brooklyn College. He's very active in writing not only on those issues but also recently on education reform. I just read a couple of articles he's written for the Washington Post, Huffington Post, and elsewhere. So he's also. Seems to be engaged as an activist on a variety of issues as well, which we'll be hearing about. The theme of our panel is there a left public sphere? When we listen to a presidential debate or any TV news discussion in the United States, the range of political ideas expressed is remarkably narrow. Especially compared to other countries, left-wing ideas are much more present in the public sphere and in public debates in many other countries, and here it is much more narrow. There are a lot of different ways that you could look at the gaps and inadequacies in our public sphere, but since our guest, Thomas Frank, is a public intellectual on the left, the gap that we're interested in for purposes of this discussion is the gap on the left side of the spectrum. So the topic we'll be discussing and the question we'll be opening with is there a left public sphere or a place for discussing left ideas, and if so, where do we find it? But before I get started with that, I want to introduce my colleague, Professor Fonke Okome. She's a professor in the political science department along with me, and she's also a professor in the women's studies and Africana studies. Her work is on African migration, globalization, and many other things. Sub-Saharan African democratization. Don't list all your research interests because there are so many of them. That's a good point. There are a lot of them. She's the author and editor of a number of books, including one forthcoming that looks incredibly relevant on state fragility in Nigeria. She's very active. Again, speaking of the public sphere, she's very active in Bring Back Our Girls NYC, which is, of course, one of the organizations working to bring back the girls in Nigeria who were kidnapped and who have disgracefully still not been found. What, 1 year ago?
It'll be 1 year on April 14th.
Yeah. Sad. So I'm so glad that you're here. Thank you for getting here. So is there a left public sphere? And if so, where do we find it? Do we want to start with you, Tom?
I guess I'm the man.
You're the man.
I'm the one.
You're the guest.
I'm the one.
So for a while, I felt like I was it as far as left public sphere. So when this is going to sound really crazy to you guys, but for a while I was a weekly columnist for the Wall Street Journal. I was on the Wall Street Journal's op-ed page, and that went on for about 2.5 years. And it was a really it was a peculiar arrangement because, first of all, the Wall Street Journal never it's a very conservative paper, their editorial page. And not only was it conservative, they didn't have any liberals at all. None. For the whatever reason, because they had determined that was the way of error or something like that. And those views didn't need to be represented. And then all of a sudden, out of the blue, they called me up one day and asked me to start writing a weekly column for them, and of course I jumped at the opportunity. But it was a very peculiar situation. Usually when they choose a Democrat or what we would call like a sort of tepid centrist liberal will write for them every now and then, but it's almost always these guys from the Democratic Leadership Council. Do you know who this is? This is sort of Bill Clinton's group in Washington, and they're always pushing the Democrats to embrace, laissez-faire, policies or something like that. Those guys will often write sort of one-off columns for the Wall Street Journal, but it was very peculiar for them to come to me, because I'm not that type. That's not who I am at all. And it was really hard going. It was really tough. It was a very difficult job. But that's not really the work is not what we're here to talk about, right?
Well, could be part of it.
But what happened? I mean, that was in 2008 when I started doing that, and there's two important points to think about. One is that if you do any kind of historical research in this country's past, you discover immediately that there was once a very thriving left-wing public sphere. Not that it matters, but so I did a lot of research once upon a time on Kansas in the 1890s. You know, don't ask me. Well, it's because I'm from there, right? So, and Kansas was filled with left-wing newspapers. I mean, it's like, so you would never think of this today. It's the strangest thing in the world. Every town had one. And they were like crazy radical. And, you know, where on earth did this come from and where did it go? It's an interesting question. Cotton Eye Joe, right? No, that's that song that was popular. I'm sorry, I have a daughter and she sings these songs. Okay, it doesn't matter. But it came from, I mean, it doesn't really, do you guys want to know where it came from? Abolitionism. So Kansas had been a deeply abolitionist state, was actually set up by people from Massachusetts who went out there to block people from Missouri moving westward. They were going to like bring their guns and stop the people from Missouri. This is where, you know, John Brown, you know who this guy was? This is where he got his bloody start. Anyhow, so the state was filled with these people who were from a fairly radical tradition, and it just kept going after that, and it passed into what they call populism. And then that eventually sort of mutated into socialism, and then eventually disappeared. And now Kansas is, well, there is no more conservative place. Well, I guess Utah might be more conservative, but it's the opposite today. It's come a really long way. But this is true no matter where you look in America, except for I guess the South or something like that. But almost anywhere anywhere that you dig in the archives, you immediately come across traces of this. A left culture that has disappeared. Now, there is one way in which it's staged a dramatic comeback just in the last few years, of course, the internet, right? Because now I mean, I've left the Wall Street Journal and now I write for Salon.com. I'm totally virtual. My name is not stamped by letterpress onto paper anywhere. And you have this very thriving kind of left-wing culture on the internet. But it's, and I'm sure we're going to talk a lot about this, so let me just start us out with one observation about the left on the internet. And that is that there's, in the past in America, the left was identified with working class people. That's what it was. It was a movement of workers, okay, and various other groups as well. But the main thrust of it was workers, organized labor, that sort of thing. Today, that from the internet, that side of it is gone. There's lots of left voices out there, some of them really awesome, and some of them really lousy, like mine. But there's no. The voice that's missing is the one that used to be so present in such a profound way all over the country. That's gone. Okay, shutting up now. I'll pass the hot potato on to you.
Actually, I was going to pass it on to.
Oh, okay. Yes.
Where is the left? Well, let me start with saying that in Nigeria, a professor, Segun Oshoba, turned 80 over the weekend. And he was he's a lefty. He's Marxist. And he was so popular when he taught. I went to college in the 1970s. He didn't teach in my university, but he was so popular when he taught that many students who took his classes were not registered for his course because they were bored with a lot of the stuff that they got from their classes. And his birthday party was an occasion where people who are leftists in Nigeria lamented the erosion and almost disappearance of the left. So where is the left, I think, has to do for Nigeria and many African countries with with international politics and the triumph of neoliberalism. And that triumph was not just a theoretical one for many people. It was something that entailed people having to make real hard bread and butter decisions about whether they were going to be employed, the terms on which they would be employed, the kinds of capacities that they had to put food on the table for their families. So, you know, I think many of these struggles, maybe people in the U.S. are more familiar with Latin American struggles. And then a lot of people are very excited by the Arab Spring and the possibilities that it presents, and they're more aware now of the contradictions of that triumph. But in the 1980s, actually from the mid-1970s until now in Africa, you know, there's been a real struggle, both ideological and also practical struggle with neoliberalism as the only game in town. And it carries a lot of resources with it. A lot of those resources are packaged as presenting opportunities to promote democracy. So women's rights organizations are sponsored by State Department funds, EU funds, and you know, CEDA from Sweden and CEDA from Canada and so forth. And you know, it's very seductive. So many people who were of the left became consultants. Because, and not because, you know, I have to also say that in this period, there was something called structural adjustment programs in African countries that made it impossible for people to actually have three square meals, not to talk about anything else. So when these funds came and they were promoting democracy, a lot of smart people jumped on the bandwagon. And it's not just strategic also. A lot of people were very frustrated by the persistence of authoritarian systems in African countries and any sort of help that they could get to battle these authoritarianisms seemed to be legitimate to them. So the seductiveness of, you know, enabling you to fight real brutal authoritarian regimes, promote women's rights, you know, girls' education and things like that enabled people to sort of sometimes hold their noses and become consultants. And, you know, very soon after, ideologues that, you know, still see themselves as passionate advocates of the people's rights, but, you know, the left has narrowed. And the left in Africa is actually not too much a people's vanguard. It's an intellectual reserve that has a lot of very problematic aspects because it's not connected often to people's, I mean, there's the theory, and the theory is hanging up here, and then there's society, and it's down here, and it's very, very impossible sometimes to separate the power structure that has the state involved from, you know, the elites who are intellectuals, who are leftists. Mm-hmm. But that terrain has narrowed significantly. But there's also virtual spaces where this left engages, oftentimes themselves, you know, a narrow circle. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the youth who are, you know, still very impressionable. Mm-hmm.
So move to another tough part of the world.
Okay, thank you. Tough part is relative. Yeah. I always say controversial.
Right.
What is controversial? People think Israel-Palestine is controversial, but I think Ferguson is just as controversial as that, for example.
Sure.
But one gets more attention than the other. We have to ask also, why does one area of war get more attention than, let's say, Syria, where 200,000 people have died, mm-hmm. and very little attention? So I think we should also think about that. I mean, this idea of, it really was interesting, this idea of left public sphere. I think you had mentioned, what does that mean, the, you know, this whole, the title of the panel opens up a lot of thoughts. And I was thinking, where do we find the left public? And the first thing that came to mind was Occupy Wall Street here in New York, or we find it in Gezi Park protests, which I took part in, as an observer. I'm not a Turkish citizen, so it's very different. My work in Turkey, when I write about Turkish politics, not being a citizen of the country, it frees me from a lot of the responsibilities that I don't have to go to the ballot box. I don't have the responsibility of going to the ballot box, which opens up criticism, which is, I think, is in a sense easier to criticize from a safe distance, although I'm a resident there, and I have my own connections that I've outlined before, because I'm constantly attacked for, being a spy, of a Zionist spy, or different things like this. So I'm,
spying on us now.
Yeah, exactly. I get paid by Twitter, the hours I sit and I waste. I don't get my book done. That's how my pay is. When I'm talking about, so we have Gezi, and we have the tent protest in Israel, also that about 4 years ago led to about 500,000 people out to the streets. Also, I think looking from this idea of left, we get confused because, I mean, when we see 20,000 people in Occupy Wall Street, everyone gets excited. And in Israel, if there's a demonstration under 30,000 people or under 100,000 people, say, it really was nothing. And that's a country of 7 million people. But that doesn't mean that all the people that are coming out are actually left also. Because what we have, I think, some of the struggles of defining the left is, what is the left? And I think our friend here talking about Nigerian politics, I will see something very similar in the Turkish politics. Well, is it the Communist Party, which I call conservative left? Because they're great leftists when it comes to Marxism, but they also have oppressed gender politics and LGBTs within their community themselves, and women, women's rights. And this continues in, for example, the Israeli Communist Party. Do you automatically slot a woman in a high position? Or do you let them struggle and say, well, we're all equal, this is a worker struggle? So where do these other struggles disappear within the left? I think it's something very huge. And how, what I call in the Israeli elections recently, how does the left silence other voices within it through this hierarchy of power, politics, and party politics? So I think I define myself as left. I never defined myself until Facebook, when they said, what are you, right? What are you? So then I put independent left, because I never joined the Communist Party, but I might support them, but I call myself independent left, right? And Facebook helped me. And that brings us to social media in a second. Just on a side note, this social media and this idea of defining yourself and this idea of what is it? Identity politics is so much part of the American society that I think it's actually, to some extent, actually harmed other left movements. This idea of asking a 13-year-old to define themselves sexually on Facebook, I think is, what are you into? This sentence it was, I don't remember. Some people answered men, women, this. And a 13-year-old suddenly has to define themselves at a very young age. This, I think, if we put all this packaging into it, what we're seeing is that there really isn't one left. There's many different left parties or left movements. And the sphere is, for me today, is creating coalitions with other movements that have similar ideologies. And through places like Twitter, I think Facebook, and other social, if it's Salon or if it's Turkish media that's now, Turkey is a different case now because we're dealing with the daily authoritarian obstacles that where when you write, you're automatically threatened by trolls, or these trolls are often paid by...
they don't hurt you,
Yeah.
They're just jerks.
Yeah. In Turkey, I would say, in Turkey, they lead to arrest of journalists.
Really?
Yeah. We have many, the trolls are paid by the government. There's 6,000 paid trolls.
That's amazing.
Something like this. Yeah.
I'm gonna use that. That's fantastic.
So in Turkey, the trolls are paid for, but we don't really know who by what. I think in this case, getting back to the idea of the dealing with And I think what you said in Nigeria, this question of authoritarian past or the problems of working within an authoritarian system or a system that's becoming more and more authoritarian all the time. This is quite difficult. The last thing I would say with making coalitions is very important. I'll just give you two examples, and then we can move on. In the Turkish case, we have a very interesting case of the Kurdish Party, the People's Democratic Party, that is creating coalitions with other Turkish, ethnically Turkish groups, the Green Party, for example. So what we have is we have a situation where the majority of people are Kurdish, 90% are Kurdish, but they have a 10% Turkish constituency supporting the Kurdish demands of equality. And very interestingly, though, even if the Kurdish part of the population is the most conservative part of the population in Turkey, they're supporting LGBT rights. It's on their agenda. And they say this over and over again, women's rights, LGBT rights, workers' rights, green environmental rights. It's very interesting. Now, on the other side, in the Israeli case, we have the joint list that just ran for the party, that for the first time, the Palestinians within Israel, not the ones under occupation, joined together. They brought Islamists, nationalists, and communists together in one party list. It's very interesting. It's a very interesting experiment. And they got 13 seats. They became the third largest party in Israel now. Okay, but this was done also with the help of other Jewish activists and other Jewish leftists that said that the Zionist left are not giving us an alternative to a joint future in the land together with Palestinians and Israelis. So while the Jewish left might be more prominent, okay, it's not giving alternatives to a future of coexistence. Let me just putting a side note to that is the minute you get out of the left consensus or the consensus left of the Jewish left, then you are also outside the consensus of media, of attention, of so the automatically the mainstream media sidelines this left, and you lose what you mentioned, the grants and different things, working with NGOs that are getting money from EU and America, which plays a huge role also. So I'll stop there. I just threw a lot in there, but yes.
All right. Well, look, yes, I agree. It is on the internet. It's on Twitter. It's on Facebook. It's under hashtags. You have to find it. It's in this realm known as Black Twitter and Latino Twitter, and whether that deals with political issues or more, or what happened on Scandal and so forth, and given that a lot of scholars also weigh in terms of what's happening there in terms of real life, in terms of the world, Latino Twitter, for example, we talk about issues from wealth and income to immigration and so forth, ideas that are, I would argue, centered to left, and also under hashtags like Nerdland, which is Melissa Harris Perry's on MSNBC's, her hashtag, and I'll critique that in a second, to Black Lives Matter, to I Am Michael Brown, so, you know, to All Kids Need, which is a public education movement to sort of, it's actually a response to neoliberalism and the shutting down of schools and charterization and so forth and all the standardized testing, to the Salons and the Boston Reviews and then the Huff Post and the Jacobins and the Dissents and so forth. And the racism reviews. So you have all of these fragmented spaces, I would argue. And I would also agree with you that it's also on the ground. In the General Assemblies, those are the so-called non-hierarchical forms of decision-making that stem from what happened in Argentina in the late 1990s. I was there during that time. To the Occupy movement here and abroad, which I believe created new spaces for the left public sphere as a reaction to neoliberalism, and specifically austerity movements. The cutting of budgets, of education, of social programs, and so forth throughout the world. They've spurred winds by democratic socialists from Greece to Spain to parts of the Americas and in Asia. And they remind us of the vital role of public institutions and spaces as necessary agents for better standards of living and redistributing wealth. But I also think it's important to be self-critical, and as a Latino studies professor, with a background in urban policy, we got to go there. Sociologist, Jürgen Habermas. Yes? Yes? Maybe? He argued that the public sphere is subject to its own territoriality, their own spaces, and he called it a bounded political community. And those bounded political communities, right, also are clearly defined by structures of race, gender, and class that exist within those frameworks and also respond to the frameworks at large. And I'll give you a quick example. Have you heard of a blogger and writer named Ta-Nehisi Coates by chance?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? He's written a very terrific piece on the role of potential role of reparations, which got a lot of talk on the internet and Twitter and so forth. He's a prolific writer. I think he's one of America's foremost, you know, public intellectuals. Well, he argued that last year he went online and he argued that Melissa Harris Perry of MSNBC was America's foremost public intellectual, and he wrote a piece. And what happened was is that an editor at Dylan Byers, a political editor, came back with a really snarky tweet saying, "You're really undermining your credibility here. How can you possibly say that?" And a lot of the folks came back.
I don't know if everybody knows who Melissa Harris Perry is, so if you want to.
Oh, Melissa Harris Perry is an African American scholar, a Tulane University professor, political scientist who has a show on MSNBC. In my view, many, many scholars, academics follow this show because she's one of the few that actually brings scholars of color, diversity to the table in a very sort of profound way. And so he names her as this, and so what happens was Byers made this snarky tweet and people came back to Byers and responded with those tweets, "You gotta qualify that. How can he not say that? What gives you the right not to say that?" And they say, "So name names, who are yours?" So he came back with names like Bernard Lewis, Noam Chomsky, Paul Krugman, and the late Susan Sontag. What Ta-Nehisi Coates responded is that, "You named all white folks, and the only woman you named is no longer with us." And so what happened was, in terms of those classes of race, class and gender that we need to talk about here, we need to look at that. You need to look at those things from those perspectives. And I also say that in the sense that even my own, I would be disingenuous if I would, in front of you, if I would not tell you that many of my own articles and appearances here and there would not have been, or even be asked to go on television and talk about the Latino community and so forth. It stems from my privilege as a Cuban American, coming from one of the most privileged groups, my whiteness and so forth. I know many of my colleagues of color have terrific work that they want to be in the public sphere, but they're not asked, largely as a response to the structures of race, class, and gender that exist within these spheres. But very quickly, I also want to go back a little bit, is that I think sometimes we have a poor definition of public intellectual. And the reason why I say that is because I was a labor organizer in Texas. And a few years before I went into academia. And one of the things I learned there is that from the janitor to the Department of Human Service worker, intellectual, philosophical, moral, and intellectual grounds were the very basis of why they wanted to join a union and to improve their standards. Mm-hmm. And they often wanted to participate in the newsletters, and even though they had never finished their college degrees. So the idea that a public intellectual must be someone, I mean, it must be a professor. This is something that, I know he's not here to defend himself, but Nicholas Kristof wrote a piece last year and said, "Professors, where are you? We need you." I said, "But wait a minute. What about journalists? What about folks like Juan Gonzalez from Democracy Now? He doesn't have a PhD. What about people who do, but not necessarily write peer-reviewed articles, like Neil deGrasse Tyson? Do you know this guy? He's awesome. All right, he's African American and Puerto Rican from the Bronx, right? Most people don't know he's an Afro-Latino. He doesn't necessarily publish all the time, but he's out there taking on the climate change deniers in these really profound ways, and talking about very complex material in a way that my 7-year-old is glued to Cosmos every night. He's 7, right? To mom and dad sitting like, oh my God, is that really what happens? You know." To folks like Diane Ravitch, public education, you know, they don't necessarily publish peer-reviewed articles and so forth. And then there are scholars who have also gone forward that you may have never heard of. There's Arlene Davila at NYU, who talks about the impact of neoliberalism, especially gentrification, in communities in New York. Victor Rios, he wrote a book called Punished, Policing the Lives of Black and Latino Men. That book is in Washington, D.C., trying to inform policy. criminal justice policy. Michelle Alexander, the new Jim Crow, right? Kimberly Crenshaw, Tressie McMillan Cotton, one of my colleagues here, Vanessa Perez Rosario, Jeanne Theoharis, who's, you know, and so forth. We can go on and on here. So I think that in closing up very quickly here, so yes, we have these confined spaces to which we exist, but also within those spaces, there are these structures that are representative of the structures at large. Last but not least, very quickly, I just got back from Cuba. And one of the things that I noticed, and we were going to talk about left ideas, I've rarely seen an op-ed in the New York Times that challenges fossil fuels and climate change in a very profound way. In other words, that says, you know what, solar power and wind and hydroelectric can be cheap and completely doable to address these immediate needs. And one of the things I learned from the Cubans is that that's one of the things that they are most concerned about, is that if the embargo opens up in a way where this mass consumption comes down, in other words, our lifestyle permeates theirs, one of their biggest concerns is that it would first erode, especially the coastal communities who are most likely to be affected by climate change. And even so, to be critical over there as well, the Cuban government has created alliances with China to dig because Cuba's sitting under a nice little fossil fuel bed, and so forth. So one of the things I learned there is that, in other words, the corporate control of the media, right? Especially New York Times and Washington Post, look who advertises there. You really think I'm going to get an op-ed that says solar power is doable and can be cheap, but the fossil fuel folks don't let us do it? They're never going to print that. They're just not going to print that. So, and if we believe that as a, I don't believe that's necessarily a left idea. I think that's a reasonable idea. I think that science backs that up. So if you think about the context of the public sphere in terms of corporate control and the interest of the 1%, you have to take that into account as to what is allowable to be published. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Tom, you had looked like you wanted to respond to a number of things.
Oh, well, so when we talk about public sphere, there's two ways of thinking about it. Well, there's many, but one way is what we've all been discussing here, which is intellectuals, public intellectuals, university intellectuals, and the other way is movement building. And what's striking to me is that we live, I mean, what you just described is really, you just described a sort of glittering, online world of all these ideas and all these thinkers, you know, going at it with one another, and it's a wonderful thing. But on the other hand, we have this very robust intellectual life in that respect. But we have this, you know, really withered culture of movement building. And my favorite example here is, well, it's something that didn't happen. It's the dog that didn't bark. We've just come through the worst crisis of capitalism. I can say that here because I'm in a university, right? I always have to be very careful not to use the word capitalism. It just sets people off. And so I've come up with all of these euphemisms over the years. The market system, blah, blah, you know, the blah, 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 the financial, financial crisis, 2008. The system was utterly discredited. It was basically almost in ruins. And who, you know, got off the dime and built a movement to take advantage of this? The Tea Party movement. The other side built a fake left. I'm sorry, the other side. Maybe some of you are conservatives or Tea Partiers. So when I say the other side, I'm referring from my perspective. The conservatives got out there in the park with their megaphones and set up a fake movement, and I'll be damned if it didn't catch on. And overnight, you've got these people protesting all over America demanding exactly the wrong things, right? But doing it as a response to something that should have been my team's, right? We should have owned that disaster. That was our baby. I mean, and we lost, frankly. We lost. They were able to turn that around, capture it. There's a Tea Party faction in Congress now. Well, they've got people running for president. One of their leaders was the party's vice presidential candidate in 2012. You know, and they're representatives of a movement that was in ruins in 2008. and now they're back. And it's, you know, that is astonishing, and that's movement building. And that's what a healthy, robust, I don't know if you'd call it healthy, there's something demented about the whole thing, but that's what a movement looks like. And so on my side, we have, like I said, this glittering world of you know, brilliant conversation. By the way, I've never felt more irrelevant or powerless as when I'm going all wrong here, but so I've written for the Wall Street Journal. There I was like an animal in a zoo. You know, I was like something to gawk at. It's like, look at this guy, you know? I was the odd man out in a huge way. Harper's Magazine, I would write these, you know, beautiful, polished essays. They would edit them, check them. They'd go through layers of editing. You know, there's the line editor, there's the copy editor, you know, on and on. Beautiful, polished thing. I was very proud of it in a literary sense. They had, you know, nobody read it. Right for Salon.com now. Lots of people read it. But there is this sense of futility that I've had at all three places that I just can't get. I mean, this is my life. I'm a public intellectual. This is what I do. And it drives me crazy. You talk about labor organizing. You know, that's something that must feel, I've never done it, but that's something that must feel like you're really getting something done. And you should comment on that. I mean, I wonder what because I have friends who are labor organizers, and they're also very pessimistic people because they only rarely meet with success.
Well, I'll respond 2 points. When I also participated in Zuccotti Park, and when I went down there, my labor organizing side came out and said, "Where are the demands?"
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. I can't lie.
But that's reasonable. But that's what they say. It's
but. But I understand that you need to foment these public ideas so as to, Greece is the most, we had the Occupy movements in Greece just recently, and if it wasn't for these non-hierarchical, sort of more consensus-building ideas that were horizontalist models, you would have never had the democratic socialist win. It was because of them. So they framed the anti-austerity narrative. But let me just go back to very quickly, Tea Party. Latinos can be quite conservative, and that's what the Tea Party doesn't get. And that is, remember, we have a very selective immigration policy. At the same time that you have all kinds of voter disenfranchisement going on, whether it's sort of from the gerrymandering to the voter IDs to the, all kinds of repression. And that's something that these folks on the right don't get. They don't understand. And it's one of the reasons why many are at the same time that I think the Democratic Party takes Latino vote for granted. Like, oh, they're going to come with us anyways. Not realizing the complexity of the community for the so-called progressive Latinos, I got to be honest, we're concerned that if the Republicans ever figure out that the Tea Parties are a bunch of racists and xenophobes, that Latinos are going to vote with Republicans. But they're not doing that. They haven't figured that out yet. And so as an organizer and someone on the progressive left, the Latino progressive left, I'm not going to lie to you. We see it. We see it but I don't think they're going to get their act together for a while.
But you mentioned a very interesting thing, which is the separation of the Democratic Party, the machinery in Washington from this world that we're talking about. This is something that drives me. I live there. And it drives me absolutely crazy. You know, we can talk all we want, and they have their, it's as though they, well, not only do they not hear us and not care about us, but they have they live in an entirely closed public sphere. It's not public, though, an entirely closed sphere that's not open to the public of their own, and they go to their experts, and they have their ways of dealing with things, and you know, we're not listened to at all. Now, I don't want to say that the right is more. No, the Republican leaders are the same way. They play the conservative movement. You know, they never get what they want or anything like that. But they are slowly but surely dragging this country in this awful direction. By the way, the right does know that they can to win over Latino votes. I mean, you've got a lot of crazies, but I mean, Ted Cruz. You know, and this is, I mean, what's his name? Rand Paul.
Where are the birthers? Wasn't he born in Canada?
Yeah, that's right. Rand.
White guy gets a pass?
Rand Paul is out there, and this is, by the way, very interesting. One of the only national politicians to show up in Ferguson was Rand Paul. You know, these guys are playing the game. And the Democrats take us for granted. They're like, well, they got nowhere else to go. You know, they always say this. And they, at the end of the day, you've got people like the Tea Party movement figuring out ways to steal from the left. And they'll, you know, they'll come with something different, you know, next time around. You know they will. They're endlessly creative. Drives me berserk. I'm sorry, I'm shutting up now.
I want to kind of interject some Nigeria, because a lot of what happens in the U.S., I think, is normal everyday politics in other places. And Nigeria is actually in the lead up to presidential elections. And I think what's possibly not so obvious here, which is, well, it's obvious, the role of money is really in graphic relief in Nigeria, because when people campaign, they would give people bags of rice, poor people, and bread, which is stamped with the candidate's name and face and everything. People would also get all kinds of welfare packages that's very, you know, nuts and bolts. You know, trade your vote for these goodies. And then there's also the fact that some people are rich enough not to be bothered by this. So the incumbent president unilaterally cut the electricity rate by half. So now, you know, even if you don't take bread, you've taken the cut. And it works to motivate you to vote for the government in power. So, you know, I think a lot of the manipulation of people and their, you know, the taking for granted of people, you know, that they would vote for X or Y or Z. In Nigeria, it's like, you know, if you're of this ethnicity because the party has this ethnicity, or you're of this religion because the party is of this religion, if you let those other folks in, they're going to change things and we don't want it. But a lot of it is also driven by money. And, you know, religion plays into it because the government also buys pastors, you know, with massive amounts of money. And we have this Nollywood industry in Nigeria, and the incumbent president has also bought Nollywood. So, you know, all the creative people are also singing, you know, in praise of the incumbent president as the transformation agent. The other side is not necessarily the left, the opposition. You know, it's a catch-all place where very clever people also want power. But because, you know, the incumbent regime is not, has always held power, well, always, since 1999, when we had the latest iteration of democracy in Nigeria, people are, the people who want change, which is the mantra of the opposition, are drawn to this side. But both sides are full of scoundrels. And, you know, the money, the role of money, people who want to have enduring influence in the oil sector, which luckily is now declining. I'm so happy.
Luckily,
yes. Because, you know, petroleum politics polluted Nigeria. It polluted the environment, the physical environment. Polluted the intellectual environment, polluted the environment for any kind of progressive, positive change in the country, and entrenched a venal bunch of kleptocrats.
Yeah, well,
both international.
That's you're talking about Texas. Saying,
yeah, no, that's why I'm saying this.
Why does oil always do that?
Well, you know, maybe it's something in the DNA of oil. But I think it's about money. The fact that, you know, you can make tremendous amounts of money, you know, exploiting this natural resource. And there's a power structure, an international power structure that supports that, you know. And what's wrong with making money and not spreading the wealth around, you know, when you can do charity? Mm. you know, which takes care of the poor. And then election time, you distribute the bread and the rice and the cooking oil, and everybody's happy.
I was going to say, in Turkey, this is a huge issue of, you know, I think the irony happened about 2 or 4 years ago when the elections, previous elections, where they passed out washing machines to a village that didn't have electricity. Right? So that was, you know, hit the headlines. But literally the day of elections, we're passing out washing machines. So this is something I think they're struggling with. I mean, the Turkish case also is, I think what you're saying also is, what's the alternative? We have to remember that in Turkey, for example, the many of the liberal left, I call liberal left because they're not affiliated with sort of communist or socialist left. Many of the liberal left supported this government, the ruling AKP government of Erdogan, for years because he did promote change. And what was that? He was going to transform the country from a country of elitists that tried to force their social leftist agenda on the masses of the population. For example, when I started teaching in Turkey for the first time in 1999, if a woman who was wearing a hijab, a covering, was in class, I would have to stop teaching it. I would have to say, get out of the room or take your headscarf off. Now, this is a country that's 99% Muslim, right? So when they came, it was very refreshing to say for the first time Kurdish people would actually speak their language. So why not give them our vote? Yes, they're Islamist, but most of my friends were giving their votes to AKP. They said they're Islamist, but they're liberal. They're open. We know how the story ended. The story ended with not an Islamic state. There's no fear, I think, that tomorrow alcohol is going to be forbidden in Turkey. Okay, but there is a fear that the presidential system is the Putinization of Turkey, the Erdogan now as a president. So of course, the secularist leftists, everyone was against them, are saying, we told you so, we told you, we told you so. So the question is, who do you make your coalitions with? And then often, you know, I find myself sometimes when I write something, some people say, oh, you sold yourself to the secular leftists. You've sold yourself to them. I say, no, I'm not selling myself to them. But, you know, there is a problem with the rise of authoritarian state, and we need to talk about this. So I think this is, you know, with these multi-party systems or trying to cleanse the failure of what was considered left 20 or 30 years ago, right? And I think maybe this, in some sense, you know, we can ask, you know, in the Israeli elections, there's a saying that said the people are stupid, the masses are stupid. The masses are foolish. They don't understand politics. This is a very leftist idea. They vote for the Republicans, even though Republicans don't promote economic reform or reform that can really help them. So in the Turkish case, the Israeli case, they're saying they're voting for the Likud, although the labor would offer much more. But remember that the labor for years was a very oppressive party that only served its own people, oppressing huge groups within the system. So you have to be crazy if you're from a small town. This is what many people think. And you're saying, you're going to vote for them? We remember up until 1977, before the Likud came in power, they oppressed us. Because we weren't Polish or Russian background and we were Moroccan background, we wouldn't get jobs. We were sidelined. So I think this is also questioning when we put in this context. I think in the American context also, you know, people, there's this memory, you know, what happened in the 1970s that made everyone switch to becoming Republicans? You know, why did my father, who voted Democratic all his life, suddenly in the Reagan years say, you know, I'm tired of these Democrats. I want something new. I want Republicans. You know, this is the Reagan years. So, and also someone, he worked in a union, he was a worker, and that switch happened. So I think, you know, that switch we have to understand. And sadly, like I said, in the Israeli elections, is that the left in Israel, they're not offering really any alternatives. Not economically. You know, they've turned into this we're anti-Netanyahu. Okay, you can be anti-Netanyahu, but offer a plan. Show us, you know, a roadmap to a better system. Oh, we're anti-occupation. But you've entrenched occupation. Over the last You know, since 1967, the labor is just as guilty as the Likud of creating settlements. So really, it doesn't come down to the peace process. I mean, that's what I'm saying in these Israel and Turkey. It's really not, I mean, the left is problematic because they support occupation. They've supported occupation. They've created the occupation. And then they come and say, well, Netanyahu strengthened the occupation. Well, who created it? It's you that created it. Turkey is the same, very similar case. With it not being a normal system, you know, where you have stability of, you had four coup d'etats in the last 100 years, or exactly in the last 80 years, four coup d'etats. So people are very suspicious always.
I think Alan wanted to jump in.
Well, speaking of coups and power, someone help me out with the name of the show on Netflix where Kevin Spacey plays the president?
Yeah.
House of Cards. Look, I've only seen a few episodes. First season, and I was like, I can't do this. But then, this last season, someone said, do you know that he's proposing a federal job guarantee? And that's the storyline. And I said, get out. Yeah.
That's so like Humphrey Hawkins or something?
So the Humphrey Hawkins Act. So I got to go on. I got to check this out. So I watched the first two episodes, and some of the points you made reminded me of this. Well, have you heard of WPA? I hope so. Please, in the Civilian Conservation Corps.
Didn't they build this college?
Yeah, exactly. Very building. I really hope you've heard. Okay, great. So back in 1978,
have people heard of the WPA?
Just the Workers' Progress Administration. All right. So a race and class critique here is that out of it came the Civilian Conservation Corps, which was supposed to rebuild the infrastructure of the United States. And so forth. And let's just be real, many white Southern men got jobs out of it, and only a few African Americans and Latinos did. So that needs to be said, because that's missing from the... There's a debate about it in the literature, but that's not underemphasized. So in 1978, Jimmy Carter and Congressman Humphrey and Hawkins, African American, and also a gentleman from Minnesota who had a backing for labor unions and so forth, they said, we need a full employment program. And we need to do that to deal with inflation, and also we have a high percentages of unemployment in the African American community, which, by the way, are at the same level as they were in 1978 today, right? So the idea was that if the private sector doesn't create jobs, then the federal government is responsible for providing the missing work. Well, then comes Reagan, and he says that's not going to happen, right? And so what happens is that we focus more on inflation, and we focus less on actually providing government sponsored jobs. So here is this Netflix show when we have this conservocrat, right?
Yeah. More or less. Yeah. No, that's exactly what he is. He's supposed to be a new Democrat. Yeah.
Who's proposing the idea, which is, I can't believe it. My colleagues and I have written about this. We have a piece on it in the Huffington Post a few years ago, and I can't remember. If you look on Twitter and that piece, all the trolls came on and said, oh, you commies, you this, you that. Yeah. They really came after us. The WPA was a very popular program. In fact, there was a movement in the 50s not to end it, in the 40s, not to end it. They're like, whoa, we've got jobs. It's building and helping build the middle class, and so forth. So now we have the idea again. But if you watch the show, it's mispresented in a way that underscores a lot of the cultural beliefs about African Americans and Latinos and women. And that is, people will never want those, they'll never want those jobs. That they're lazy, that they have a poor work ethic, that those culture of poverty folks from the 1960s and the Daniel Patrick Moynihans, that they were right, that there's a culture of poverty and we have to undo it and so forth. And so that the show permeates those sort of ideas given those who are critiquing it and so forth. But I think I want to point out, but it's interesting that Netflix made the idea popular when Congressman John Conyers has been proposing the idea.
That's right.
For many, many years. He's been saying, we need jobs. How about green infrastructure? How about, instead of Teach for America, right, which in my view displaces unionized teachers, especially of color, why don't we have a federal job program that lets you, students, education majors, have an entryway into schools, and you are paid a decent salary, and you also have worker protection? I mean, those are just some of the ideas that can stem from the WPA and that can be modernized today. Unfortunately, we get it in these Netflixes and these shows, and they trivialize it, and it's really hurt by all of the corruption and the greed and this, you know, and all kinds of stuff. But I just wanted to make that point.
That's funny. I didn't know that they were. I watched all of season one of that because I was writing an essay for Harper's about cynicism towards Washington, which is always intriguing to me because it's we all hate Washington, but we often don't know why we hate Washington. And so I was intrigued that there were three TV shows running at the same time that were cynical about Washington. There was that one, there was Scandal on ABC, and what's the third one? Now I'm forgetting what it was. Oh, Veep.
Veep.
Right? And all of these things are running at the same time, and they're all very cynical about the motives of our elected officials in Washington. And all of them for really shallow reasons. But that is a turn that I would never have thought of because at the same time, like the month after that, I wrote an article calling for a new WPA and sat down with my friends and dreamed up all the things that this new WPA could do. And that was fun to write, by the way, just to think of all, like what you could do with this enormous population of unemployed people in America, you know? My best idea was to send them into the libraries of this country and scan every old newspaper ever printed in America and put it online for free. And then you'd solve unemployment forever because we'd all just be wasting our time reading those old newspapers, you know, on the internet. No one would want a job after that. I'm sorry. That's okay. That's my joke.
What happened to that essay? Did you publish?
About the cynicism?
No, the one
about the WPA? Yeah, yeah, sure, but it was in Harper's. It's
in
not
Harper's, but nobody read it.
Yeah. Well, I read it. I read my own essay. Yeah, and my mom read it.
Assign it to your kids.
So I had a lot of things I wanted to follow up on, but I see there's already people wanting to ask questions from the floor. So so why don't we open it up to questions. I think you can go and
okay.
Students will
first
jump in.
First of all, I hate that Netflix, the show in the second season. It's all an exchange for Medicare, Medicaid, and the social safety net.
Right.
By the way, speaking of cynical. So it's not the same as the WPA. So. But here's my question.
Right.
Well, it's kind of academics, I'm sorry, it's a comment question. One of the things that I think is missing from the conversation and missing from building movements, and I'd like you all to speak to this, is we always forget that the internet is part of the project, the neoliberal project. It is technocrats and efficiency experts who launched this whole thing, World War II and during the Cold War, and Maggie Thatcher's wonderful, there is no alternative. Tina has overwhelmed not just the right, but the left since the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991. And it seems to me that if there is and part of the problem with the internet is we're all speaking to ourselves.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right?
And it's spying on us. That's the other one.
And
it's a real spy. It's not a...
spied on by advertisers.
Yeah.
And the government and everything. So I would like you to respond to the following idea. If there's really a left movement and it's robust online, then one of the greatest ways to make a statement is start a movement online to have days to shut down the internet because that would really help the neoliberals where they live. So could you respond to that?
Sure, and I'm glad you raised that because I think that that brings out a theme that I wanted to bring out from several people, especially Tom and Funke's comments. Let's respond to that.
It's funny because I wasn't I didn't go on Facebook until I decided to do Bring Back Our Girls. And I didn't go on Twitter until I decided to fight the Nigerian minister for, what is she now? She's the coordinating minister as well as the minister for finance. Because I was on LinkedIn and she wanted us to be friends. And she said, she tried to manipulate me into supporting government policy. So I organized people to challenge that. So I think it's possible to have an illegitimate tool and to create an unintended consequence of using that tool to serve purposes that are opposite of what people want to do. And, you know, it's frightening that people are doing this level of surveillance on everything that one does. But at some point, you have to just ignore that and say, well, you know, let them be. Anybody that tries to surveil and make sense of what I do and claims to understand why I do them needs a Nobel Prize because it's inscrutable. However, it's inscrutable. I mean, they can reach their own conclusions, but they can't get in my mind. I think that what you suggest of boycotting is actually an intriguing thing. What I said to many people is once the Nigerian girls are found, I'm getting off Facebook and Twitter. And nobody believes this because it's so seductive. But you know, so I think those boycotts need to be organized. And then there's not one left, there are many. And because of the size of agenda and the differentials, you know, we don't talk to one another. Many people are totally unaware, apart from knowing some Nigerian girls are missing, Boko Haram is involved, and what happened to those girls? Many people don't know what the heck is going on. And that's even an idea that has captured world imagination. So much of what happens in many parts of Africa that are not cool and sexy or troubled enough to be like the man bites dog thing, nobody knows about. But, you know, I think it's enough that the people who are interested in those issues are talking to one another. And one thing that these things offer is I'm here in New York. I can talk to people in Nigeria and people in Scandinavia who are Nigerians and so forth. So although they're very flawed and very problematic tools, they offer those possibilities. But, you know, the boycotts to shake up those complacent fat cats, it's a good idea.
On that note, just quickly, I wanted to clarify some things I said before. But first of all, Twitter and Facebook has been numerous times banned by the Turkish government. I mean, and they haven't been able to hold the ban. I mean, you have so many ways that you can get around it. It's very relevant also that the government uses these tools very well. Is if it's through, and this is where I'm going to correct myself, if it's through the thousands of paid trolls following us, or is it through the fact that people that defame the once Prime Minister, now President Erdogan, are subject to jail time for defaming president, which is basically just criticism towards towards the president, has led, I think, a lot of people to also ask themselves, really, is this the place I should be? And it really has led to self-censorship. The other is I think what you said, I forget what it's called, hashtag politics, or, you know, every 2 weeks, or there's
activism.
Every 2 weeks or 3 weeks is a new thing that captures our minds, and then we forget 2 weeks later about bring our girls home, that bring our boys home, that Israel used, you know, after the bring our girls home, there were three boys kidnapped in Israel.
Mm-hmm,
They changed it into bring our boys home, and that took over for 2 weeks. What I can say about the limitations of this is we see that although Gezi was very popular, the Gezi protests on Twitter, when continued violence against Kurdish populations occurs in the southeast and not in the urban arenas where everyone exists, people don't hear about it or read about it or even care so much about it. So we know about the names of the people killed in Gezi one by one. I can name all seven right now. But the last, you know, the 10 people or the 5 children killed 2 months ago, we don't know their names. So that's also the limitations of it. I like the idea to boycott it for 24 hours, but it is very seductive. I don't think I could hold up to that.
Just as a clarification, we tend to forget that there was a very robust critique on the left of military-industrial complex, which is now the military-industrial academic prison complex. And who developed these technologies, and who's on top of this stuff? I think it's important. I'm not saying you can't...
microwaves.
You know, I appreciate communicating, but people were on the streets before the internet.
That's right.
Notice they're not, you have this problem yet.
Well, so the myth of the internet intrigues me. Look, I think that the reason I'm there rather than in Harper's Magazine, I'm your test case. I never particularly liked the internet. I've always been a print person. I mean, I started my own magazine and would lay it out physically with, you know, wax and, you know, a waxer and the blue boards and all that sort of thing. And none of you will ever have to do this. But we physically printed that baby, you know, on a letterpress machine, and then I would drive it around in my car.
Still a print.
No, that's right. But I'm not doing it anymore. Yeah. And you know, Harper's Magazine is this absolutely resolute commitment to print, and I love what they do. You know, as far as I'm concerned, the best magazine out there. It's beautifully edited, fact-checked, fantastic publication. If y'all don't know about it, you should go out and get one. But don't try reading it online because it's like very, very, very difficult. And I, you know, I had to go where the readers were, and so here I am. Now I am virtual Tom Frank. But I want to point out two things about this.
Really,
look, I just don't have a choice. You know, if I want people to read what I'm writing, then that's where I had to go. And I want to point out that our State Department currently, under the Democrats, one of their most, and this is Hillary Clinton's State Department, their great principle is internet freedom. And they to hear them talk about it, this is as important as opposing communism back in the old days. This is it. Internet freedom is what we are spreading to the countries of the benighted, you know, regions of the world that don't have it, and we are going to force, you know, you say the Turkish government has... tried to close these things down. That is an outrage, sir. And we, you know, America will do everything in our power to get Facebook back up there because that is freedom, you know, Facebook. And it reminds me, I mean, it's so ridiculous, you know, because we all know what it really is, which is big data. This is, by the way, one of the great, you know, one of the great moments of the last few years that the cultural turning points of the last few years that we really have yet to understand is that moment, and I think it was after the Snowden revelations, when everybody figured out that their phones were spying on them. You know, because before that, I remember in the Occupy days, people thought the phone, your iPhone or whatever, was this instrument of liberation, sort of participating in this narrative that's been going on. By the way, this narrative that predates the internet. And that's what I wanted to get to. If you go back to, I used to, back in the 90s, I wrote about a lot of this technological liberationism, where people think new technologies are always going to free you. And there was a guy wrote a book about this, about the march of technology overthrowing different regimes. And the idea was that the cassette tape overthrew the Shah of Iran, mm-hmm. and the VCR overthrew the Philippine government, Marcos? Yeah. And you could go down the list and make these things up, and the fax machine overthrew somebody. You know, and you know who wrote this book? Guess who wrote it? This is the punchline. The CEO of Citibank. Walter Wriston, you know? That's but that idea has so utterly permeated the culture. We all think that's true. So even Occupy is going, you know, they think their cell phone is an instrument of liberation. And look, to some degree it is. But it also is spying on you. And that's the trap that we're in. The big data, the Democrats now think I'm changing subjects again here. The Democrats don't think they need to persuade us anymore. Big data is what wins elections, and they are absolutely dedicated to this idea. Okay, shutting up there. But I don't. You can't shut it down. That's not going to happen.
We're talking about movement building.
Well, movement building is. Look,
it's many things to many people. Did
you want to?
Yeah, very quickly. Just got back from Cuba. One of the things that they're primarily concerned about is the opening. This. Mm-hmm. And there's a tension between the older generation and the folks who actually go back and forth. And the old generation and Afro-Cubans who are less likely to have family in the diaspora are the ones that are actually express concern, saying, what does this mean for us? Will the collectivism, the sort of, whether or not, and this comes from folks who are both critical of the one-party system and not, I got to tell you. And they're really concerned about, they understand who owns what. And they understand what that could mean, and will that come with uber mass consumption? Will that come with, you know, that basically that destroys the social fabrics and the public institutions that have been built? However they may be critical of Fidel and his brother and this and that, that happens at the same time. And it can, and it should be allowed. But I think you pose a critical question. I should tell the group that not having access to the internet for 5 days was, I felt cleansed.
Now you're polluted again.
It was unreal, you know. And I was dealing. I was, when I got back and flew into Tampa, I was literally like shaking, as if I was getting rid of a caffeine addiction.
I
gotta check my phone. I have a son, and so my wife was here, but that was the. But yes, thank you.
I feel like we could follow up in this in so many ways, but yeah. I want to see if a student has a question. In fact, I'm hoping that a student will have a question. Yeah.
So we're just discussing like how you especially were saying like there's hierarchies within like the left wing, you know, like how some certain voices are silenced, and we're talking about how the government, people in power aren't necessarily listening to the people in the public sphere, talking about House of Cards and how it's basically a ballet of like political corruption. So my question is really like, do you think there's some inherent flaw in the two-party system that silences the
ballet? Oh, yeah.
All the voices out there, because everyone just kind of conforms to one side or the other, and it kind of shuts out actual discussion.
Absolutely, there's a problem. The problem is the two-party system, and the fact that the two-party system is, and this is going to be a shock to you guys, enshrined in law in this country. People don't know that. They think, well, you can just have a third party and challenge them. That's not the case. You can't. I mean, you can set one up if you want, but you can't. In the 19th century, this country had a you might say, a more robust democracy than we have now. There were new parties coming up all the time, and that doesn't happen anymore. You have third parties that are personality-based, like Ross Perot, Ralph Nader, La Follette back in the 20s, but you don't have a mass third party, like the Populist Party, which was my favorite, or the Socialist Party, or the Republican Party started as a third party movement. And why don't you have this? Because after the last big third party movement, the Populists in the 1890s, which they were all over the country, and they were not just sending, they were not just running a guy for president, they were taking over state legislatures and electing governors and all of this stuff, and it was scary because they talked like socialists. Every state in America made their strategy illegal. Okay, and their strategy had been to fuse, they called it fusion. They would fuse with one of the two major parties. And so in Kansas, which was a one-party Republican state, they would fuse with the Democrats and win elections that way. And you go down to like Georgia or somewhere like that, and they would fuse with the Republican Party. Georgia was a one-party Democratic state, and they would win elections there. Illegal now. There's no good constitutional or democratic reason for it to be illegal. It's just illegal because the two parties want to preserve their monopoly. They have a monopoly, and that allows for all sorts of crazy dynamics.
Career politicians,
people who take us for granted and take the voters that you're talking about for utterly for granted. And in the Republican Party, so the Democratic Party has reacted to, I've written a lot about this, as you might guess. The Democratic Party has reacted to this in one way, which is to constantly, they act like a cartel. They constantly want to have fixed prices with their opponent. Constantly, it's like Archer Daniels Midland, if you guys remember back. They constantly want to have that meeting in the hotel room where they fix everything with the Republicans. And Obama calls it a grand bargain, right? They're always after that. What are the Republicans always doing? They're like, no, we're going to push everything as far to the right as we can. They're playing it by this different strategy, but these are both strategies that are determined by the basic rules of the game, the two-party system. And you overturn those rules, and my God, you would have so much choice. I mean, it'd make the, you know, forget the internet. This is where you'd really start having consumer choices then. And you know what would be best about all that? I'm sorry, I'm going to make fun of your discipline here.
Oh, it's not. I'm not even a political scientist.
You'd put the political scientists of America out of business because their entire discipline is based on the permanence of the two-party system. And all of a sudden, you know, they'd add a little bit to the unemployment rolls, but. Sorry. They go the way of the Sovietologists, you know.
I mean, I'm not a political scientist, and Funke's not an Americanist, so what do we care?
It'll never happen anyway. It'll never happen.
So, I think we really could go on all morning, but I believe we are now required to let you guys leave.
Evacuate the premises.
So this has been a great, you guys.